shadow of her famous ex-husband. He was an all-American guy trying to become a movie star. Their brutal killings stunned the nation. Number two, the murders of Nicole Brown Simpson and Ron Goldman. On the surface, Nicole Brown and O.J. Simpson seemed like a happy Hollywood couple. But behind closed doors, the marriage was troubled.
I saw pictures of Nicole Brown Simpson beat up. I heard that 911 call, that, you know, the transcript of that, that she saved in a safe deposit box. And I know she was a victim of domestic violence.
Nicole and O.J. divorced in October 1992. They continued to raise their children together, living in the same Brentwood, California neighborhood.
This is a very important part of their lives, was to keep up a cordial environment so that their kids would try to grow up in a healthy manner.
But for Nicole, everything came to an end on the night of June 12, 1994. Around 7 p.m., Nicole had dinner with her children and her mother at Mezzaluna Trattoria in Brentwood.
So she returns home. Her mother calls and says she left her glasses behind at Mezzaluna restaurant. And so Nicole calls the restaurant, and one of the waiters agrees to bring the glasses over to her house.
The waiter was Nicole's friend, Ron Goldman.
When he left, he said to me, he said, do you want me to call you? And I said, yeah, you can call me or I'll call you. And he said, great. And then he walked one way and then walked another. And the last words that I ever heard from him was, I'll see you later.
Goldman arrived at Nicole's condo around 10:15 p.m.
Mr. Simpson came out of the condo to let Mr. Goldman in the gate. And at that point is when they were attacked.
According to the autopsy reports, an assailant stabbed Ron 11 times with a knife at least 6 inches long. During the struggle, the killer cut Ron multiple times on the neck and scalp and struck him with a blunt object on the back of his head.
He was basically cornered in a very small area. He was unarmed. And you really, as hard as you fight, eventually, especially with the loss of blood, you lose acuity and you pass out. And as hard as he fought, he really had no chance because he couldn't get away.
The killer also attacked Nicole.
What happened with Nicole Simpson, she had a cut of the neck. It went down 2 inches to the bone.
If you sustain a cut that deep, you're pretty much not going to survive because you can't breathe. You're bleeding out. It's fatal.
Nicole was stabbed 7 more times in her neck and scalp. She was also struck on the back of the head. Police found 25-year-old Ron and 35-year-old Nicole dead on the front steps just after midnight.
Anytime you have somebody stabbed or shot or bludgeoned multiple times, your first indication that somebody was very angry, that this is a crime of passion.
You have to love a person a great deal to keep injuring the person after death, and that's part of the rage reactions.
In the days that followed, investigators discovered a bloody glove, bloody shoe prints, and other suspicious items at the murder site.
Both these victims were stabbed. It was a very personal thing, and for that reason, I'm sure it led the investigators to think that quite possibly it was a domestic situation.
According to police reports, O.J. Simpson became the prime suspect.
There was his blood all over the crime scene. There was the victim's blood in his car. There was a mountain of forensic evidence.
On June 17th, a warrant was issued for O.J.'s arrest. That afternoon, Simpson and his longtime friend Al Cowling led police on a now famous low-speed car chase in his white Bronco. O.J. eventually surrendered at his Brentwood home. In January 1995, Simpson went on trial for the double homicide. The case became a media circus.
At this time, do you wish to enter a plea guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty.
It touched on all these issues of race, of celebrity, of wealth, of popularity in our society. It had something for everyone, in essence. And I don't mean to talk about it in such a detached way, but I think for all of us, that's what it became. It became something other than the fact that this man was on trial for murder. It became a cultural moment, a phenomenon.
If it doesn't fit, you must acquit.
The O.J. Simpson, Nicole Simpson case was, at least in my memory, the most watched event in the history of pop culture.
On October 3rd, 1995, nearly 100 million people tuned in to hear the verdict.
The jury in the above entitled action find the defendant Orenthal James Simpson not guilty of the crime of murder in violation of Penal Code Section 187A, a felony upon Nicole Brown Simpson.
I think the O.J. verdict happened, the acquittal, because one, O.J. could afford to have a whole team of fabulous lawyers. Second of all, you had O.J. Simpson. He was an all-American hero. People didn't want to believe he could commit such a crime.
No one else has been arrested for the murders.
Regardless of what happened, I don't think anybody came out a winner. Yeah, he's not in jail, but, you know, his life is turned all the way around. It's just one big tragedy.
Under the law, he was acquitted. Then he went on to the civil trial.
In the 1997 civil trial, O.J. Simpson was found liable for the killings. O.J. was ordered to pay the victims' families $33.5 million.
The most terrible thing about the case is that no one's paying for it. You know, no one is in jail for this. These two people are dead, but no one is paying the price for these two murders.
Up next, Hell in the Hollywood Hills, the number one most horrifying Hollywood murder. August 8, 1969, four people broke into a secluded house in the Hollywood Hills. One of the intruders announced, "I am the devil and I have come to do the devil's work." Number one, the Manson murders.
No case had a more prominent victims that were totally innocent, that were absolutely slaughtered by this cult element.
Charlie Manson was an ex-con, failed musician, and self-proclaimed prophet to a fanatical group of followers known as the Family.
Manson desperately wanted to be a rock star. Hung out with the Beach Boys, cut a few songs.
Charles Manson was pissed off at the Beach Boys and their producer, Terry Melcher. Terry Melcher, the producer, cut Manson off because Manson was so crazy, and it enraged him because Manson was getting a taste of fame.
Manson called upon his followers to exact revenge. The only problem, they didn't know where to find Melcher.
He knew that Melcher no longer lived there at 10050 Cielo Drive, but he knew that somebody prominent lived there.
That prominent couple was director Roman Polanski and his wife, actress Sharon Tate. Tate starred in the film Valley of the Dolls. Polanski was working in London that summer and asked friends to stay with Sharon.
Manson wanted to commit some shocking murders.
Charles Manson sent family members Tex Watson, Susan Atkins, Patricia Krenwinkel, and Linda Kasabian on a mission.
As they were driving out from Spahn Ranch, he leaned in the car and said, "Leave a sign, something witchy."
In this group, he was God. He was mini-God. He decided who lived, who died. He decided how the murders would take place.
The first to die was Stephen Parent, a recent high school grad who was visiting the Gardner.
Stephen Parent begged him, please don't kill me. Please don't do anything. I won't say anything. Watson shot him four times at point-blank range.
Jay Sebring, a renowned Hollywood hairstylist, was next.
And Watson smashed him in the face with the gun and then shot him.
Wojtek Frykowski, a Polish actor and close friend to Polanski, was stabbed 51 times and shot twice. His head was partially caved in by the butt of a gun.
Watson then went over to help Patricia Krenwinkel stab Abigail Folger.
Abigail Folger, heiress to the Folger coffee fortune, bled to death, the result of 28 stab wounds.
And after they took care of her, Watson went back in the residence Susan Atkins had Sharon Tate at knife point.
Sharon was 8 months pregnant.
Sharon was crying and begging and pleading. She said, look, please, please don't hurt me. All I want to do is have my baby. Please let me have my baby.
Sharon Tate had 16 stab wounds, and of those 16 stab wounds, only 3 of the stab wounds were considered fatal. Just simply one where the person was just stabbing indiscriminately.
Sharon's blood was found smeared on the front door, spelling out the word pig.
One common element in anybody that commits these types of crimes is to shock people, to shock the community, to create a sense of terror, and that somehow embraces them, makes them feel powerful.
Manson hoped to spark a race war and then rule over the post-apocalyptic world himself.
Charlie Manson's Helter Skelter was a war that the Manson family were going to start between the blacks and the whites. Manson was going to jumpstart this war by making it appear like black people had done these murders.
The next night, members of the family found 2 more victims, a Los Angeles couple, the LaBiancas.
The LaBianca killings the next night was again, I believe, a matter of convenience to kill them. It was just by chance, simply by chance.
The killers used a fork to carve war into one of the bodies. The city of Los Angeles was in a state of shock.
People started locking their doors, locking their windows. That was the only subject people were talking about, was these mass murderers who were out there killing and brutalizing people.
It was a completely random situation, which is why it was so scary. It's why all of LA went crazy then, because it was like, oh my gosh, so who would kill these people? And in such a brutal way.
Loose talk by several Manson family members led to their eventual arrest. On January 15, 1971, a jury found Charles Manson, Patricia Krenwinkle, Susan Atkins, and Leslie Van Houten each guilty of murder and conspiracy to commit murder. Charles Tex Watson was found guilty of the same crimes at a later trial.
One of the most famous misconceptions about this group of murders is that Charlie Manson had blood on his hands, and it's not true. Charlie Manson never actually killed anyone of those 7 victims.
Charles Manson has been up for parole 10 times. Each time, he's been denied.
Over the past 3 decades, Charles Manson has become almost a symbol of what ultimate darkness and evil represent.
These aren't people you would have initially thought of to be such cold-blooded murderers. That in itself is pretty darn scary.
These are the people we know. The famous, the beautiful, the powerful. Gone, but never forgotten.